Good evening and welcome to First Presbyterian Church. If you would please open your bulletins to page 11 for the evening service portion of the announcements. Instead of asking the catechism question, which you can read at some point later during the service, I want to ask a different question tonight. It's posted right here on the, it's this: how long does it take to read through the entire Bible in a year? Well, I was contemplating that question today, and I asked my son during his nap to count the number of words in the Bible. He reported back to me after 30 minutes that there are 775,000 words in the Old Testament and New Testament. Well, if you take that number and you divide it by 365 days in a year, it comes out to about 2,123 words that you'll need to read a day. And most of you read anywhere from 200 to 225 words per minute. So that comes out to about 9.4 minutes per day. I've got a little logo here of the Gospel Coalition, and let me just encourage you that there is a post that was put up by Justin Taylor a couple days ago, and it's describing frequently asked questions about reading the Bible. Not only does it have about six different platforms to read through the Bible and plans, it has an incredible wealth of information about the Bible as a whole. There's a whole project going on where they're summarizing each book of the Bible with these little cartoon caricatures that can be used for adults and children that summarize the books in less than 2 minutes. It's wonderfully done. So take a minute between now and the beginning of the week and look through that post and find a plan that works for you this year. And if you've ever wondered, is this the year to read through the Bible? Well, the Lord has given you one extra day. This is a leap year. You've got one extra day to catch up in case you fall behind. Our call to worship will come from Jeremiah 31. Please stand for that and I'll pray as we begin our service. Jeremiah 31 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I've drawn you with unfailing kindness. Father, this text reminds us of your work in the past and the work that you are yet to do. You are a God of kindness. You are one who leads us in love. Lord, if there is one in here tonight who knows not of this love in deep and meaningful ways, would today be the day of salvation in his or her life? And for those of us who know of this love, would you place it more and more at the center of our lives to motivate us towards godliness this year and years to come? We ask this in your name. Amen. These songs testify to the love, the boundless love of God that will indeed never let us go, both in the morning and in the evening through song and sermon. This message is proclaimed to us. And tonight, the sacrament of baptism will realize once again of the boundless love of God. God has been wanting to convince a reluctant people of His grace and His love to us. We see this in the earliest of chapters in Genesis chapter 17, as Abraham is still wrestling to consider who this great God is. And God tells him three times, "Abraham, my love is not limited to you. It's to you and to your children and to future generations." God's covenantal love, it's multi-generational. God's covenantal love is family-centered. The Apostle Peter picks on that same very theme in Acts chapter 2, where nations are gathering and they're asking, "How will we be saved?" And Peter says, God's plan of salvation is not just for you. It's for your children and for future generations, those who are far off. We indeed are those who are far off. And God has called us to Himself, and we have the joy tonight of receiving another covenant family in our midst. Not only will it be two people, it will be their entire family. And as we see this family baptized, would we too remember once again that God loves working through families. God loves working through multiple generations. With this in mind, would the bookers please come to the baptismal font with Elder Lynch. Chris and Han, you'll be joining the church tonight, so I'm going to start by asking you the five questions we ask all the people who join the church, and then I'll ask you some questions regarding the baptism as well. Chris and Han, please reply, "I do," after each one of these questions. Do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving His displeasure, without hope except in His sovereign mercy? Do you? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and rest upon Him alone for salvation as is offered in the gospel? Do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? Do you? And finally, do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? And finally, do you submit yourselves to the government and discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Do you? As we will baptize not only you, your children tonight, the same God who calls you to Himself, who you look to give you rest, we look the same promises for your children as well. As their parents, I'm going to ask you some questions regarding their baptisms. Last three questions I have for you. Do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you claim God's covenant promises in their behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation as you do for your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to children to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before them a godly example, that you will pray with and for them, that you will teach them the doctrines of faith, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, do you? Now, First Presbyterian Church, I ask you, do you promise to assist this family in this high calling of following the Lord Jesus Christ, both in their lives and as they strive to lead their family in the same direction? If you're able to from the heart, please reply with an amen. Elder Lynch, you pray for this family.
Father, we do just thank you for the Booker family, and we thank you that you bring families to yourself. We are thankful for the blessing they are to our church family, and ask that you would help integrate them, find places for them to serve, and that we would love each other well. We thank you for their children, for Andrew, Christopher, and Sydney. We ask that you would allow us the pleasure of helping to teach them and bring them up in the admonition of the Lord, assisting the family. And we ask these things in your name. Amen.
If you would, please, Neil. Chris Booker, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Han Booker, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Andrew Booker, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christopher Booker, child of the covenant, I baptize him the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Sydney Booker, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this covenant, this boundless covenant that calls people who are far off, who are undeserved. And Father, your love for us is so wide, so deep, that you not only call us, you call our children to yourself. Oh Lord, would you work the realization of that grace deeper and deeper into our lives? Would you distinguish this church as one that knows and loves you above all else? And would we begin this year, as we are now, celebrating your love for your people? It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Please come forward for tonight's offering. If you are new with us, we would like to particularly welcome you. If you'd like to learn more about the church, on January the 24th, we'll be having a six-week in choirs class, and we would love for you to attend that. There's some announcements about that in the bulletin. As was mentioned this morning in the announcements regarding last year's giving, we did end with a surplus. It takes us about another week or so to figure out exactly where we ended the year, but we'll give you exact details about that and what we as a church plan to do with that surplus and line it up with our mission. Let's pray for tonight's offering. Our Father, thank you for this past year and the generous giving of this church. And Father, as Jeremiah reminds us, you're not only a God who works in the past, but you are a God who works in the present and in the future. And we would ask, O Lord, that not only would you make us thank you for what you have done, but would we anticipate what you are going to do in and through us. Take these gifts now and use them to further your mission in this world of redeeming a people. In your name, amen.
in vain the builder strive. Tomorrow's gain, tell me, what is your life? A mist that vanishes at dawn, all glory be to Christ. All glory be to Christ our King, all glory be to Christ.
Oh. Please turn in your Bibles to the Epistle of 1 John. It's found on page 1898 in the Bible provided for you in the pew. We want to make the connection that John makes between the incarnation of Jesus and our mission in the world. And we've just begun again in January our gospel priorities emphasis. And we heard this morning from a local pastor here, and we're looking forward to hearing from others. I want to just, as we begin again, every year, we want to look at gospel priorities and be reminded of our mission in the world. So 1 John chapter 1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testify to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard so that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. Let's pray together. Father, I ask that you would open our eyes, that you would teach us what your gospel does both in us and through us by your Holy Spirit. And as we begin a new year, renew in us our gospel priority to live and fulfill your mission in the world, that we might share the life and light and love of Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This epistle written by John really explains this intimate connection that we have with God because of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, first experienced through his incarnation and then through the crucifixion and resurrection. And he summarizes why he wrote the letter. He does say here in the first, "These things I write." So he's explaining at some level a clue about why he wrote the letter, what he just said in verses 1 through 5. But he more explicitly explains it in 1 John 5:13. If you'll flip to the end there, might be a familiar memory verse for you. He says, "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God in order that you may know that you have eternal life." So John says, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, and chapter 5 are written as reminders that you might know that you have eternal life, that you've experienced something from God now that you are in union with God. And that experience is that life has come down to us and light has come down to us and love has been brought to us. And we experience that first in the incarnation and then secondly through the crucifixion. And John goes on to explain how our experience with God, our union with Him, points others to the light and the life and the love of God. Those three themes that are themes that recur in the book of 1 John. The life of God, the light of God, and the love of God. So I want to start with this term or this phrase, God in the flesh. God's mercy has come down in the incarnation. This had to be a strange concept for the Greeks. Strange concept for the Greeks, no doubt. The idea that the Son, who has existed with the Father from the beginning, has entered into human history, that God has become a man and taken on human flesh, this man Jesus. And these phrases in the beginning really parallel to John's beginning in the Gospel of John. We'll look at that in just a second. But think about this for just a second. In Plato's teaching and in Plato's world, the material world was evil. Plato's dualism was that there was a dramatic demarcation between the physical world and the spiritual world. And this idea of dualism was carried into the church, the Gnostic teaching, where they were trying to integrate Christianity and this idea that somehow or another Jesus is our life and light and love, but he didn't touch our flesh. He didn't touch this evil in the world. And yet John points out very clearly that that's not the truth, that Jesus has come. We've seen him with our eyes. We've touched him. Our hands have handled him. He's come in human flesh. But I think it's helpful to read John chapter 1 and parallel these two beginnings. Flip over there to John 1 briefly. And I want to just read verses 1 through 14 as he elaborates on this incarnational presence that God has come down into our world as a man. It says, "In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, he was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men." John's picking up on that theme even in the gospel of life and light. "The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness does not understand it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." So John picks right back up with this idea that Jesus is unique, and he has come into the world as the only Son. We saw that in verse 1, or chapter 1, verse 14. He goes on in 18, chapter 1, verse 18, 3:14, 3:16. But he's also the pre-existent one. We saw that in John 1 and John 1, 14. But also this, not only is Jesus the only Son, not only is he pre-existent, but he has a relationship with the Father that is unparalleled. He says that in John 1, 14, but he also says that here in 1 John. Read verses 1 through 3 again with me. Listen to this. "That which was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we've looked at and touched," this is our experience, right? "What we have experienced and having touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it, testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us." Verse 3, "We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us." And here's the most important part about the uniqueness of Jesus. "And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." Jesus has this unique relationship with the Father. And by his incarnation and through his crucifixion, he brings us into this unique relationship with the Father. That's the most unique part of the incarnation for us, is that it brings us into a relationship with the Father. In short, John picks up on what it means to have a relationship with God through Jesus by looking at those three themes there. The theme of life. In just the book of 1 John, 15 different times he uses that word life. And then he looks at light. 6 times in the first 20 verses, he looks at this unique relationship that we have with God that brings us into light. And then love 36 times in the short epistle, John refers to this unique relationship with the Father is an experience of love that calls us to be those who express God's love. So how? The conclusion is simply this. The incarnation is significant because it brings us into fellowship with God. And now that we're in fellowship with God, it brings our mission, it aligns our mission with the mission of God. And our mission is to be those who point to the life and the light and the love of God. So first, God in the flesh, now ministry in the flesh. Now that phrase, ministry in the flesh, may throw you off a bit because most of the time when you read that phrase, in the flesh, it seems to be referring to the sinful nature. But because of the incarnation and our union with God, John is saying we have a ministry in the flesh and we are to incarnate this gospel that's come to us, is working in us. It's also to spread through us. And he lists at least three ways that we incarnate the gospel. And you can see on your outline there if you have the outline before you. First, by understanding that we've been sent. Secondly, by our own experience of seeing this gospel light. And then third, by sharing that. So we're going to look at how we incarnate the ministry of the incarnation in the flesh. First, by this idea of being sent, I actually was tempted to use the word called here, and you think about those two words, they seem actually more, I guess you could say, unorthodox or contradictory. The word called sounds like come here, and the word sent sounds like go there. And yet, what John is saying to us is that we have been sent by virtue of the fact that Jesus has been sent to come and rescue us, by virtue of the fact that we now, our life is found in God, we're sent, we're called. You could say it this way, our union and our communion with Him has now led us to participation with Him to expand His work in the world. You're called to live in this light. You're called to live the life of God. Now, in the New Testament, the word life, I guess there's three words that are used meaning life. One is the bios in Luke chapter 8, where it talks about anxiety and riches and pleasure of this life. It's talking about the Greek word there is just the physical body. But in Matthew 16, it's the word suche, which is what we get our word psychology from. And in Matthew 16, where it says, whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. He's talking about the soul, the human mind, emotions, and the totality of the person. But in John 1:4, it says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. That's the word zoe, which is the Greek word that's used here, and it's the word that John uses every single time in the little epistle of 1 John. It's the same word that's used in John 3:16, where it says John 3:16, help me with that. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have zoe, that eternal life, right? And here, every time John uses the word life, he's talking about this eternal life. Now, he's not just talking about, that word is not just talking about a quantity of life. He's talking about a qualitative experience. He uses that word in John 17 when he explains what eternal life is. John 17:3, it says this, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the eternal God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. And this is eternal life, that they may know you. So eternal life, or this quality of life that we're talking about here, is a life of relationship with God, the eternal God. And that starts when God comes into your life and transforms your life. So being sent means we live out of this reality that God has chosen to come live his life with us. And we live that life out of our passions, out of who we are, in our human flesh. Think about it like this. You know when Moses was called, or sent, you could say, he was called, come here, but he was sent, go there, to go and to tell Pharaoh to free God's people. You remember what Moses said? No, I'm not going. And he said, Lord, you know, I don't have anything to offer. And he says, I'm not eloquent. I don't have any gifts. I don't know what to say. I can't prove to anybody that you sent me. And what does God say? Well, what do you have in your hands? And he looked down and he had a staff in his hand, right? An old shepherd's staff that he used to herd sheep and to work with the herds. And God said, throw down what you have in your hand. You've been sent. You've been called. The life of God has come to you, and now the life of God's to be expressed through you. Throw down what's in your hand. And you know that from that staff, God used Moses not only to proclaim the power of God, but to lead the people of Israel out of bondage. Well, in many ways, that's what it means to be sent. It doesn't mean that that your life is something that you would recommend to other people, that you would hold up and you would say, you know, I'm here to save you. I'm here to change you. But it does mean that you look around and you say, what's God put in your hands? What's God given you by way of skills? What's God given you by way of desires or passions? And he says, I want you to throw that down. If you are in an employment in a certain field, God says, throw that down. If you're a lawyer, God says, throw that down. If you're a physician, God says, throw that down. If you live in a neighborhood, God says, throw that down. If you're a college student, God says, throw that down. If you have interest in reading or sports, whatever it might be, God says, throw that down. In what way does that advance the life of God? Well, by throwing that down, it proclaims two things. One, it's a declaration that you're dependent upon God. You've let go of whatever it is in your hand. You're not holding that as your sense of security. But it's also saying, Lord, whatever I have, you can use to advance your work in the world. And that's how God uses us to advance the life of God in the world, by throwing down what he's put in our hands. I was thinking back, someone was asking me about, I'll have to say, regularly I hear this, how did things start in your ministry downtown? Did you always have a vibrant ministry to those in Old Town? And I said, well, you know, we've been here 200 years, so I guess we were older than Old Town, if you could track it back before then. But there'd come a time in our history where the only thing that was downtown about First Presbyterian Church was our zip code. Most of our people lived out in the suburbs, and we came down here to worship, but we had become very estranged from the neighborhood. And about the time that the Lord brought a new pastor, brought George to come here, the Lord was stirring within our membership. And I always say there was a moving of membership and a moving of our leadership that led us to rethink what it means to love our neighbor and to ask the question, are we really loving our neighbor? A couple of things that were happening. Linda Tuccheroni and Jan Hitchcock began to think about education. And that was something that Linda had been trained in, and she'd been teaching for many years at Westminster. But that was something that she could throw down, and she said, you know, I spend, right after, I talked to her one day after a chapel service at Westminster, and she said, I spend all my time educating students to some degree in Christian education, and I wonder, are these the kids that have, that really have the most access to Christian teaching with Christian families? I want to throw that down. I want to ask, how could God use me to take Christian education to those who are the least accessible? She said, Mike, does that sound like a crazy idea? And I said, well, maybe that's God's dream growing inside of you. And through a lot of different circumstances, God led them to start Heritage Academy. About that time, Robert Campbell and Grant Scarborough, members of our church, had been involved in Memphis, and they began to ask questions. How could we serve the poor in our community? How could we take our skills as and physicians? And they threw those skills down. They said, Lord, we want to ask you, how could you use us? And through others guiding them, like Gary Boudreau and others, Christ Community Health Services began. Just taking what they had in their hands and throwing that down. Jason Medlin was a school teacher, and he said, I want to not only teach students that seem to have the least going for them, but I want to live close to them. And Jason Medlin and others moved downtown. Just members who took what they had, opened their hands, and said, "Lord, could you use me?" They really believed that they were sent on mission. That's what John says is the first step to living out the life of God. Taking what God has given you, throwing it down, and saying, "How can you advance your work?" But he doesn't say it's just that we're sent. He also says that we're to be seeing something. It's kind of interesting to think about that when you think about witness, it's more about what you've seen. It's not about just telling what you've heard. It's more about what you've seen. It's speaking of our experience. Our union with Christ sends us out to spread the light of the world. We have seen the light of the world, and that becomes our proclamation. Now think about this. You maybe have heard this phrase, bearers of bad news. You know, here's the person that's the bearer of bad news, or the contrarian, or we used to read the Winnie the Pooh stories, the Eeyore in the family, the person who comes around and you know what's coming. They're going to remind you what's the bad that's coming next. They're talking about the cloud or the storm that's to come. They're going to remind you that if you feel good, if things are going well, don't worry. Tomorrow it's going to get bad, right? Well, what John tells us is that we are children of the light. We're children of the light. And he says that when Jesus broke in, he says that in John 1, his light was the light of men. What's he talking about there? I think what he's talking about there is in a world full of fear, we bring the light, we bring hope. In a world full of hate, we bring healing. In a world full of hurt, we bring a sense that there is a rescue coming. We're called to share this hope. Think about Matthew 5:16, where he says, "Let your light shine in such a way that others see your good works and give glory to God." What's the light there? It's the light of the hope that we believe, the hope that leads us to serve, to care, the hope that leads us to give. 1 Peter 3:15 puts it this way, set apart Christ as Lord in your heart, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account of the hope that is in you. To give an account of the hope that is in you. It's because the light of the gospel of the glory of God has shone into our hearts. And we're people of hope. And we're people who bring hope. And John says, we bring life, but we also bring light. We bring that sense of hope. That theme of life and light is going to be part of what we're going to study in our missions conference this year. We're going to read a book together, and we'll have some to sell in the next few weeks. It's called Next Christians. It's by Gabe Lyons, and he's talking about restoring hope. And what he talks about there is that, here's a quote that I think is helpful. He says, "We're talking about how to live out our values, the values of the kingdom, and to live them out in our own human skin." How do we as Christians live out our values and live them out in our own human skin? Because we bring light, we bring hope, we bring help. It's not this culture that is trying to conquer others, and it's not a culture that's accommodating and just adapting to the culture, but it's a culture that brings hope, that brings light. John says that ministry in the flesh is that we're sent, and that we've seen something that has changed us. But he also says it's something that we share. Love has come down, and love has transformed us. And that love has told us that we now have a home. We now belong. You know, in the book of John, he uses the phrase abide. He uses that over and over again. But he also picks up that in chapter 4 or 5. He picks up on that theme of abide. What does abide mean? Well, it means dwell. But really what it means is to build a home, to be at home, to be welcomed in a home. And John says that now that we are in Christ, because he's come down and and changed us. We have a home. We belong. We'll never be alone again. We have a family. The incarnation teaches us, not only are we part of a family, it teaches us to build a family. Was that not just a touching experience, seeing that family on their knees being baptized just a few minutes ago? I was just thinking, Lord, to give us the privilege to be a family that brings families into your fellowship. That's the love of God. That's the light of God. That's the life of God. We're part of a family. What shaped the Christians' understanding? The understanding that they're part of a family. It's that God had come down. God had come down and built a family. I was telling Jeff Drake before the service, I said, I'm going to embarrass you and your wife and let Jennifer know this ahead of time. I was thinking about the Drake family and their children, both born to them, but also those children that they adopted. And it was after Cynthia was adopted, and I was talking to Jennifer and Jeff, and they were talking about, they were making plans and preparation for another child. And they began to say that they were looking in Africa, and they had some, and they felt like that they had the right child. And so I just thought, well, can I ask you, why do you feel compelled? I'm just curious to know, why do you feel compelled to add another child to that chaos called the Drake home? And a little bit like the Hearon home, you know, just always some kind of action going on. Why do you feel compelled? And just quietly, Jennifer, a little quiver in her lip, said, I feel like there's this boy on the other side of the world, and he needs a home, and he needs our home, and God wants us to go find him and bring him to our home, and will you pray that this will work out, because we're going to go get him. And I remember when it did work out, and I remember even a couple of weeks ago when he was baptized, it was like, that's how it's supposed to be. We belong in a family. We belong in the mission of God, and the incarnation says that we have a mission. And it's a life that brings light and hope. And it brings love that builds a family. Now, this doesn't mean that it won't be costly. It doesn't mean that it won't be sacrificed. It doesn't mean that we won't be uncomfortable. In fact, I'm sure that it will be very costly. Where do you get that? Where do you get that motivation? It'll be very uncomfortable. Where do you gain that kind of strength? Where do you gain that kind of motivation? Where do you find the heart to live like that, to reflect that light, to love like that? Well, John goes on to say that in the end of chapter 1. Look first in verse 7. He says, if we walk in the light, he is in the light, for we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. It's not just the incarnation. It's why Jesus came was to secure our fellowship with the Father, to make sure that we were not left out in the cold, to make sure that we had a home, to make sure that we had the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. It wasn't just about his relationship with the Father and his fellowship. It was about our fellowship. And there'll be times when we feel that sense of mission. But John says there'll be times when we lose that sense of mission. Look at chapter 2. He says, my little children, I write this to you that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father on our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. There's going to be times when we lose sight of our mission. And it says that we can go to him. And he's praying to the Father for us. He's an advocate who's saying, you know what? He belongs to me. Let me work with him a little longer, Lord. Let me shape that heart. Let me remind him of my love. Let me point him back to this life. Let me remind him the truth in the light of the gospel. Let him experience the cross. And as we confess our sins, it says he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to renew our sense of mission. I'll ask you this first Sunday in January, have you renewed your mission with the life and the light and the love of God? I would challenge you to spend this week just renewing your mission. The incarnation defines us and reminds us that the true meaning of this life is fellowship with God. The light of God reminds us that all of human life, regardless of social status, wealth, and achievement, is deserving of God's dignity, and we're to point them to the light of hope. And the incarnation reminds us of His love. We're a part of a great drama that God has chosen for us to participate in, and we're called to serve. Let me ask you and challenge you this week to renew your mission. I thought I'd close by telling you a story that I had seen on the internet, on YouTube, and I'll reference it here in a minute. I won't do it now because y'all probably already be searching YouTube for it. But it's about Gainesville Correctional High School. It was a Texas high school for boys who've been convicted of serious crimes, young boys, that required incarceration, but they were still a part of a high school. Now, the reward for those boys for good behavior is they could play the sport of their choice. And many of those boys, Texas boys, chose to play football. So Gainesville Correctional High School plays, as you would expect, all of their games on the road. No home games for the Gainesville Correctional High School. And they also have to play under some pretty tight rules. None of their family can attend the games. And they go before the game in a bus that has, you know, obviously guards, and it's very restrictive. They stay there just briefly, and then they're back again. But those that perform, have good behavior, are able to participate. But they interviewed the boys when they go to the typical games, and these were some of the quotes that they got. They said, usually they don't treat us as a regular person in the world. They treat us like we're some kind of aliens. Another boy said, they look at us like we're animals in a cage, like we don't deserve a second chance, like we don't deserve another opportunity. Of course, they had this season lost all their games. They were coming up to their last game, their final game of the year. But this year, their final game was in Grapevine, Texas, and they were playing a school, Faith Christian Academy. And Chris Hogan, the head coach of Faith Christian Academy, began to think about those boys and began to think about what they experience every game. And so he sent out a letter to all the parents of his players. And I'll just read you a little bit of what he said in the letter. He says, these young men will not have any family members cheering for them. Outside of the school faculty, no parents can be there. I would like for some of you parents to consider being fans that would sit on the visitor's side and would cheer for the Gainesville team. Sent the letter out, of course, some of the parents read the letter and they thought, well, that'll be nice, you know, we'd like to kind of try that. But when the game began, it said that the boys initially thought that they were on the wrong side warming up. They came down here to warm up and they looked at their side, and their side was full of fans. One boy said, I just thought they must have so many fans that their fans are filling up both sides. I had no idea why they were on our side. But right before the game began, the boys began to turn to their coach and they said, why are all of those parents out on the field on our end? And the coach said, they're forming a spirit line. They're forming a spirit line and they're going to cheer for the Gainesville Tornadoes. They're going to cheer for us. And of course, the boys felt really nervous about it. And they said, you know, is that really true? He said, yeah, they're going to cheer for us. And so they ran out and later on said, it's the first time they've ever had anybody cheer for them. And one of the boys said, you know, he said, when I was playing, I could hear my name being yelled. They knew my name. And he said that, he said, one time I made a penalty, and he said, I was like, that's unfair. That's, you know, he said, I wanted to tell the referee, that's not fair. And all of a sudden I heard this lady yell, that's a bad call. That's unfair. And I felt like that was maybe my mama, what my mama would say when something bad like that happened to me. One of the moms was interviewed and she said, You know, they were like ours that night. I remember really that little quarterback, and I felt like he belonged to me for that moment. You know, the coach said, our kids were kids for the first time, and they learned, maybe for that one moment, that they were just the same, just like other kids. And then the quarterback said, it didn't matter whether we won or lost. It was the first time in a long time that I believed that someone was in my corner. After the game, the boys were so excited. They lost the game, of course, but they were so excited that they tried to give the coach, basically a water bath, because they said, you know, this is something we've never experienced. Later, one of the boys said, you know, I come from a broken family. And he said, I've been told that my family loves me, and I've been told that God loves me, but I never really believed that anybody else loved me. And, of course, if you do look it up, just look up Game of Hope. Game of Hope, which is on YouTube, and you'll find Gainesville State and see the story. Well, that's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be bringing a kind of hope. Maybe so radical that we would cheer for the other team. And right now, I'm really accepting any Clemson fans that want to cheer for Alabama as your godly sanctification. You're probably more godly than me in that. But there's something about the way that we should live that should make people think, do you really care? Am I really that important? Why are you including me? Why are you looking after me? It's because the life and the light and the love of God has come down and it's changed us. And he said, come join me and take that love and light to the world. Let's pray. Thank you, God, that you have come down and put on another's uniform and chosen to love us and to give us hope when we don't deserve it. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us a mission, and I would pray in this new year that we renew our mission, that we have a relationship with you because of Jesus, and that we're called to share that light, that we might be men and women who show the love of Christ to a broken and hurting world. Show us how to do that in our workplaces, on the sports teams of our children, in our schools, in our neighborhoods. Lord, let there be an aroma, and let there be something so different about how we live that others would see our good works and give glory to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ alone, my hope is found.
one of those players said, it didn't matter that we lost, because for the first time in a long time, I realized that someone was in my corner. Raise your hands and receive God's benediction. As you go out and ask God to show others that someone is in their corner, that Jesus himself has come down in the flesh to bring life and light, that hope and also that love. May he use you as you stand in others' corners and point them to Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.